say I think he's a bit lonely, because when he was asked, I believe he decided it was only appropriate they brought a few other people along.
That's right.
So
that's it.
I'm going to let you introduce who you brought along. I don't think we've enough seats for everybody, so if you think we should bring one or two up at a time or whatever, I'll leave that for your decision.
David Scaife, very, very old friend of mine. And I'm very pleased to say Roy Mapple.
Downhill already.
Yeah.
So, where do we want to begin?
Well,
introduction.
Well, go on. Yeah, I think we'll start at where it began. Ian, your first go.
Well,
where did you start?
I started here, Clitheroe Car Club. Clitheroe Car Club and Primrose Garage. That's where it all started for me. I was an apprentice at Primrose. And everyone, all the staff, they were all into rallying or driving tests, and they out at lunchtime and within minutes and doing the handbrake turns on the car park, and everybody was into it. Of course, I met Trevor Roberts, and then I went out watching a few events and got more and more interested, and got my first Mini, and then of course that's where it all really started. Joined Clitheroe Car Club, and I went on from there.
So how long ago would this be? Shall we not mention that?
We're talking 60. Well, they were still making Mini Cooper S Mark 1s. So it must have been 66, 67, I would think, yeah, something like that. Yeah. And then in this, it would probably be about 1970, I went working with Brian Harper at Minisport. So left Primrose, carried on with the apprenticeship, but working with the Brian. I stayed there for probably 3 years, and then went on my own. Opened a little accessory shop in Burnley on a corner of the main road in what was it called?
Corn Road.
That's right, 74 Corn Road. Yeah, servicing cars in the street on the cobble street, jacking the cars, servicing, tuning them. No rolling road in those days, so I was up and down Barden. Is it Barden Lane? That was my track for testing them, and then got more and more involved in the rallying side. I did a lot of 12 car rallies, night rallies every other weekend. Every other Saturday night, out doing a night rally. Various cars, just about everything you can imagine that was out at the time. Minis and Escorts and Avengers and 3 litre Capri. That was one of my favourites. Cheap power.
Yeah.
And you could keep it on the tarmac, a bloody great car, great car. And then I got a BDA, my first BDA Mark II.
Well, before we jump too far ahead,
yeah.
David, whereabouts did you start, and how did you get involved in it?
I didn't do it. Driving tests and quarry tests I started on, and about 1964. 64, right? Where?
Something like that.
64,
yeah. I wasn't living with you then.
About 64. And then we got on to rallying after Foot and Mouth, which would be 68, 69, I think, in a Mark 1 Cortina. And a Mark 2 Cortina.
That's it.
Then escort. Oh, Opel works. Opel. Yeah. Just road rallying. I wasn't interested in stage rallying at all. Like, too dear.
And whereabouts were you based then?
I was bred and born in Ambleside. and I've been in motor trade all my life, like, you know.
So were you then, would it be Kirby Lonsdale or?
Furness. Started with Furness and then Kirby Lonsdale. And then I did a bit with Waddington and all, like, you know,
They were always a big club up there.
Yeah, a lad here navigated for me, headmaster Dave Sherwin, he was a big noise in Waddington. But I never entered under Waddington, I always entered under Kirby or Furness, you know. But yeah, they were good days, very good days.
So Roy?
Yeah, well, I started in the early 60s. I was wild when I was younger, I mean, I'm talking really wild. But my men's uncle, he had quite a big garage and he was a mini agent. And the first thing I bought was a minivan out at scrapyard that had been slumped up the back. I cut it in two. He's the owner of it now. I cut it in two and put a car back end on it. And I put a 997 Cooper engine in it. And I started with that, but the 997 engine didn't last so long. I put a 998 in eventually, and we did very well with that. But I was very, very lucky. You know, you had to have good navigators like Jeff and, you know, stuff like that. And I was lucky that I did have good navigators. They really wanted to ride with me. And you can be the fastest man in the world. If you go the wrong way, you went the wrong way fastest. And it's not good. And so I was very fortunate. And I do believe that your navigator is probably 80% of your crew. You know, you can be really fast with a worked car and have me navigating for you, and you finish no work. You know, and it makes a big difference. And I was very, very lucky. I had good navigators. And from the word go, Graham Miles was my first navigator. Eventually, we didn't wear the car out, but it was looking a bit sad. And my uncle bought me a new car, 970 Cooper F. I never rallied in the early days above 1,000cc. It was always under 1,000cc. And like Cyril Bolton was in the 1,500cc minis and stuff like this, you know. But mine was always at 970, and that was a fantastic car. Rev. 8 miles to the gallon it did in our rally. And we did very, very well with that car. And I never bumped it. I was good at thumping them, like, you know.
8 miles to the gallon. How many miles did you get off the set of brake pads?
I rallied a BMW. I rallied a BMW, a 2002. That was a write-off as well. I went back into it. I had a bad accident, not rallying, and my son got hurt very bad, and I never rallied for about 3 years. And a lad come along, and I bought the BMW 2002, and roof was flat, it rolled, but it would drive. And he bet me a fiver. He said, rallying gone fast these days, Map. He said, you'll never do anything in it. And I said, I'll finish in top 10 in this car. It was Tuesday, rally was on, Hall Trophy, started from here, Primrose Garage. And a lad called Don Davidson navigating for me. Good navigator, but I never had a navigator after. He never navigated for me no more. And we'd come out in this rally, and the only thing I bought for it was a jack roof out, put plastic windows inside, and put a new windscreen in it. And we won that rally by 7 minutes, beating this laddie here. I did three rallies in a row with that car, and it were quick.
You did, but right.
I couldn't stop it.
I was glad when you crashed it.
I used three sets of brake pads on one rally. And there were two petrol alts on it, and the last one was at Dunsop Bridge. And we had to grind a pair of 1800 brake pads down for the mid caliper, he helped me, and we won first three rallies with that car in 7 minutes by 7 minutes. All three we won by 7 minutes, and third one was Bramall Trophy, and I crashed out on that. I'll say that. Oh, I will. I hit a gate stew with it. I don't know whether you won them, Jeff, or not. No, I hit a gate stew, and it beat the engine at front, and bonnet just opened that way. another great thing on that car was windscreen. And I sat on the bulkhead to shove radiator off the engine, because it was an aluminium radiator and it never leaked. And I shoved it off the engine with my foot and my arse went through the windscreen. Right, that's enough for me for a bit.
So, we'll jump back to Ian. So, you'd gone up through to an escort.
Yeah, up to an escort.
Still road rallying.
Road rallying, and did a stage event with that car. It was ex Valida car, I think it was. Wasn't it, Eric? Remember it? The Valida car.
Sorry,
the Valida car, wasn't it? Yeah, that's right. Valida sponsored car from.
We went to buy it, didn't we?
We did, that's right. Hey? Yeah.
I had to go home from work, still fully time. We're going to buy a car, Datsun 240Z he's driving. Can I drive it? No, I'll drive, we'll get there quicker. So we get to see, what's he called, Pete Wagstaff, the owner, director of Valida, yeah?
I thought it was Malcolm Byron.
No, Malcolm Byron it was, yeah, Malcolm Byron. So we get there, and on the grass verge, near a lamppost, is a fairly sad-looking BDA. It had had a minor incident on the Saturday night rally, hadn't it?
Mm.
So Ian turns to him and says, we're not buying that very quick. So, I said, well, come all this way. So we go in the house, meet Malcolm's wife, who shows us all these bills, which have been produced by Tony Drummond.
That's it.
Stockton on Forest. And coming out, like a roll in a toilet roll. Engine, right down to the detailed stuff. It rolled 1700 BDA, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's it.
And jokingly, I said he's been up all night as Malcolm making these bills up, you know. And I think you took me almost literally, didn't you? But enough to say he had a ride, and Malcolm said, well, I'll take it while it warms up. And I'm stood outside, and you can hear in the distance, like standing in a forest, you know, revs are building up, like a bee in a house or something like that. And I know you said you'd drive it, but you drove it back. And when we got back, he couldn't pay the man quick enough, could he?
No, that was what a great car.
So he then, I think he had a couple of arrangements for courting or something. You left me with the car to straighten it, didn't you? So notching the bobby to the headlights and the spotlights. And I never thought you drove it as well as some of your more standard cars, being honest. Like your RS2000.
Yeah, it was a hell of a good car, 1700 BDA. That's right, but I did do a stage event in that car, and I won the stage event,
and that's what really got me interested in stage rallies.
I'm quite surprised myself, I didn't think the car was that quick, but it obviously was.
It didn't have mini lights, did it? You have the alternative, Campagnolo.
That's right, and spurs,
but it just didn't look as the, you know, the escort works. It was a bit rough, but a good car.
So that got me interested in stage events, but then I must have sold that, and I think probably the Caprice came later, that did the year before.
You had that yellow Caprice several times yourself, and the lad who was the baker involved.
That's right.
Do you remember coming and picking me up in a 6-4?
Yeah.
You had most of Austin and all the competitions at the time, hadn't you? Because I was examining the egg gaskets where they chopped the cylinders off.
Where they chopped the cylinders off in it. Oh, that was another era, that's right. The metro days, yeah.
That jumped forward a bit.
That was Cyril's fault.
So just going back, you won the first stage rally then. Was that the first stage rally you'd ever done?
I think it was.
So what would that have been?
Whatever it couldn't have been. I haven't done many. There were a few escorts.
Was it the Waddington?
It was Waddington Car Club, was it? Which airfield would it be up there?
Great Orton. No, not Great Orton. Where?
Near Workington.
Yeah. Whitehead Club.
Whitehead Club, that's right. Kirkbride Airfield, yeah. That's what it was, yeah. Yeah.
I don't even remember club. I don't remember.
Yeah, well, that's right.
So then back to
road rallies again. I think the Caprice was the Caprice after that. I think, wasn't it?
Do you remember doing course car on the leg? That's what I'm confused with. had an RS2000 that I bought off. It had a very flat chassis rail on it. He came through the stage and it was a hell of a thump. I thought the bottom was coming out, blue and blue deckled.
That's right.
One. Anyway,
TC143M.
You were going well. I said, you were going well. He said, I'm fastest time at day through that stage.
That was a good car. That was a good car as well, yeah.
TC43,
yeah.
That was
Neil
Hudson.
Yeah, one foot. Yeah,
Henry
right.
Shelby.
That's right, yeah, that's it.
I remember.
Dave
well.
Used to do all the repairs. I used to drop them off, didn't I, sometimes? Yeah. Up there. Drop them off at Dave's, get home somehow, get a lifter back on the train, and then pick them up a week later.
Ready for the next event.
Ready for the next event, yeah, that's right, yeah. But I wasn't really, really into stages that much. It was mainly road rallies and quite a few motor news events and everything.
So we've been to the 70s now, right?
Yeah, into the 70s now, yeah. And then, do you want me to go on from there?
No, go on.
Right, well, and then I kept looking at these internationals. I thought, yeah, I really do fancy doing an international. So I think the first one was probably the Circuit of Ireland, but it was all done on a shoestring. Didn't manage to get a service crew together. And we went over and did that in an Escort Mark II, a 1.3. And we won the class with that. And that sort of went on to other things then. Did the Welsh and the Mintex and all done on a shoestring. Got through the season. And then the following season, I was lucky enough to get a drive with Vauxhall.
So would that have been effectively the British Championship?
It was, yeah, it was, yeah. And it all came back. I didn't do all the rounds, but I remember the one in Ireland. That's really where Vauxhall got interested. We got on a stage called Mull's Gap, I think it's called, on the circuit. And we somehow run out of tyres and we're running on road tyres or something. I can't just remember what happened. But anyway, we're going over Mull's Gap. It was a long stage. And a long, long uphill and then a long, long downhill after it, and I could see this car coming whizzing up behind me. Obviously a lot faster car, didn't know what the hell it was. Got on the top, going down to the side, and then he was right behind me, and I could see every now and again indicate left for him to come past me, and I could see this crash helmet, he's just going like that through them, and I thought he wasn't coming. All right, keep it going, lads, and get them into the stage. And it turned out it was Brian Wiggins, and he was one of the managers on the GM team. And he'd obviously got delayed. He was in a works box, so he'd been delayed somewhere, and that's how he finished up getting behind me. So I went over to him. I said, "Oh, I said, I'm sorry if I held you up over there." I says, "Oh, but you didn't lose too much time." He says, "There was no way we're going past you. No way we're going past you." I said to my mate Tony, that's Tony Shepherd, his navigator. He says, he's off. No, he isn't like in the next corner. No, he isn't. And we got round the whole rally, the same about, and we won the class again. And I think we beat one of the works Vauxhalls, but it was 1.3 class. So then, letter in the post, would I be interested in some sponsorship? I bought my own car, which was an Astra 1.2, which I converted to 1.3, and did a full season of the Open Championship with that car. And then again, won the championship. So, and then, what happened after that? Offered another car then, which was the Astra GTE. So that was a brand new car supplied by Vauxhall.
So then you'd have been up against Brian by that time.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, up against Brian. Yeah, that's right. And then did another six or eight events. It was good, happy days, really good. I think I did about 33, I think, international rallies altogether.
So the Vauxhall days would have been
'79 to '83.
So would that have been around the time when Harry Hockley was...
Harry Hockley was in the same class, yeah. He was in the Nova, yeah. And I was in the Astra. And I won the championship one year, and then he won it the following year. And that's how it was. So, really, really good days.
Just interrupting again, sorry, Ian. The Mall's Gap car was an interesting one, wasn't it? It was a yellow 1300 Avenger, bought from Brighouse Car Options with 98,000 miles.
That's the one, yeah. It wasn't the Escort, that's right, because we did that event with no service crew.
Yeah. Rear-wheel drive and everything.
Rear-wheel drive, yeah, we had all the wheels and the tyres and the off shafts and all the rest, it was all in the boat, and repaired it as we went along.
All that in a 1300?
Eh?
All that in a 1300?
In a 1300, yeah. Yeah. But it was affordable. You know, it was affordable rallying. It's all we could do at the time, and that's what we did, and enjoyed every minute of it.
Who was that in meeting?
Where
it top
in? Kentop. Oh, goodness me! Right, he was terrible. But what a good laugh. I mean, he thought navigation. He thought it was his idea of navigation was in between the stages. The best way to do with him was follow that car, and that's what we had to do. And then when we got on the stages, you were lucky. You was reading the right pace notes off the right stage, because very often, because I didn't take any notice of him, he was going away on his pace notes. And I said to the end, I said, "Well, the hell, Ken, that went all right." He says, "Well, it would have done if I was reading the right notes off the right stage." Absolutely mad. But a good laugh. But we got round, we finished all right, won the class again. I remember we were changing brake pads and brake shoes on. We pulled up in Belfast before the Parc Fermé, and all these police come crowding around, surround us, Land Rovers and stuff. And Ken said, what's up like? So, do you know where you are, lads? You're on the end of the Falls Road. This is when all the trouble was in Ireland. And we were changing brake pads and shoes and all sorts of things. And then with a wheel bearing that seized up, and that welded itself onto the shaft, and with all that to contact. But we still got round, and we still won the class, and happy days. I've lost contact with Ken. I don't know if anybody.
He's living at Salterford, I think. Yeah.
He's where?
Living at Salterford, near Anchor Inn.
Oh, is he? Ah, what a character!
It wouldn't be so fair for
him. He was the worst navigator, but the best fun.
Was he sober?
Huh?
Was he sober?
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah. I mean. He was drinking as we were going round, yeah. Guinness. I had a bloody hot water bottle in it, it weren't full of water.
Oh, we were once marshalling on a night event, and we were in with chocolate in TR7. And he'd come in to finish selective, and it weren't what time it were. Oh, here, Charlie, get rid of these empties for me.
he were a case, honestly. And the year after, he serviced for me, was short of someone to drive the service car. And you have this Citroen DS thing, and every now and then it disappears. I'm just going for some fuel, like, you know. So, oh, I said, where's he gone? There's no garage. He's right. You're going at local farms, putting ready. Absolutely mad. Mad, but great fun.
So,
I had the most fun with him, definitely.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So, around this time, Dave, what were you doing in the late 60s and early 70s? Through the 70s, really.
We came down. Did Clitheroe run the tennis clubs? It was Clitheroe Matty Club, yeah.
No, it was SDZ.
Was it SDZ? Clitheroe, I remember with Joe we won the Clitheroe, but we won the tennis clubs three times. We were just, you know, we weren't doing any championships, didn't do any championships till 1973 in Mexico, and we did the ANCC, John Vipond and I did that, and we didn't win a single rally, but we were always there, and we won the championship, didn't we? Was it for you? We were under you, weren't we then?
Yeah, I think so, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It was 73, wasn't it?
Yeah, it would be about that, yeah.
Aye, and then obviously that got sold off, and we kept on plugging away. I like the east side. We won the Hexham and the Three Rivers, and won about four or five over there, because it suited an RS2000, it was just absolutely flat back over there. Dangerous, but flat back. I really, really loved it over there. I enjoyed it. But I liked it down here, and I liked it in Derbyshire as well. We had good success. All, you know, a lot of people said, oh, well, you know, you only do RL Brown and all that, but we used to do 12 to 14 events a year all over. Like, never could do any good in Wales. Won one in Wales. And then after that, on Motor News Series in 1984, John and I did it in the Sunbeam, just after they'd altered rules, and we couldn't, it was 1800 Brazilian blocked one. Once you took Webers off it, it were useless. And in the end, you didn't, Harry Radcliffe made a manifold for it, put SUs on it, didn't he?
Yeah.
And then it went,
yeah.
But by that time, it was too late. And we ended up, I think, about 6th or 7th in championship, you know, but couldn't stir it in Wales at all. And I thought, I'm going to put a bloody escort together. And we put an escort together. RS 2001. I brought some photos there if anybody's interested. One that Joe ride in, and you know that I finished off with Joe. Does anybody know Joe? Fantastic navigator, best navigator I ever went with was Joe. Wasn't he, Charlie? he could do it, couldn't he? I mean, I'd had Vipond, I'd won them with Millington, I won one, two with Oric, of, sorry about that. But Joe, Dave Sherwin, now he was from up the West Coast now. Dave was, he was very brilliant, wasn't he?
Mm.
And Ron Palmer, he finished road rallying. And he went on to win the BTRDA with Malcolm Wilson. You know, he changed camps, obviously. But I just loved it. Like, I mean, when it all finished, my missus used to say to me, "You are a bad tempered bastard." You know, But no, I missed it so much. And I don't know whether we had the best days. There's Dan and his brother, you know, the Willens, and I've watched them once or twice, and by Christ, they're bloody quick in those protons. Like, I think they're having a sabbatical, aren't they?
I think so.
Yeah. And who's taken over now? Is it Ludwig Garriget up at Bentham there? Harrison, Tony. And they are, you know, I guess they're quite interesting again. I put a Mark II Lotus Cortina together, and we went and did the Top Gear, the Illuminations, and I just couldn't hack it going over them doers, and you know, 16 mile an hour, 32 mile an hour, they were doing my bloody head in, like. And but we ended up fourth on that, and then we came down on a real icy one down, and Bob Bean and all, a lot of them. We did the Clitheroe 100, 400, 800. We came and did that. Thoroughly enjoyed that. They gave us the best turned out car on that. That was all right. Anyways, I don't know whether you remember the laddie who navigated for Dougie Hall. Gareth. Gareth and I decided to go down into Leeds and, you know, down to airport to try this rally. Well, it was snowing and icy. And I thought, and you know, I had pencils behind me, a bloody rubber in my mouth, and I was looking at the bloody clocks, and it was like a right good team do, like, because they were hard. Then with it being, the weather being so bad, we thoroughly enjoyed that, and we lost that rally by 12 seconds, you know, so that's the way it goes.
Still got it, although.
Yeah, but I don't want to do it. I couldn't do it. I don't think I could do it now, and I don't know, you know, I feel really sorry. Where's the next rally drivers coming from with the cost? Like, I mean, how the hell, you know, you look at these cars. I mean, I'm a big friend of Ian Joel's, and I do a lot of work with Ian, and the cost is just unbelievable, you know. Phew, I don't know. How do you do it? I'm gonna hand you over to Roy, but I'll leave that one with you. I mean, we used to beg, steal and borrow, like, you know, well, not steal, but we used to beg and borrow. I'll just tell you a little story. There was a guy called Reynolds. My dad was on motor torpedo boats during the war. He was an engineer. And Reynolds, and a fellow called Billy Wright, he was in with him and all. He used to play football or something for Wolverhampton Wanderers in England or something. Anyways, he went to Boreham, and he opened me an account with Boreham. And I used to get all sorts of things. And he rang me up. About 19, when the Mark 1 Escort, he says, "We've got some shells here, trim shells, you remember?"
Mm.
And he said, "How many do you want?" Well, I thought, bloody hell. And I was very friendly with the lady at the time, and her father was extremely rich, so I persuaded him to bankroll me, and we bought 10. And I got a mate of mine who had an Arctic to pull them up, and we loaded them that way. And we could get 5 on his trailer, and we sheeted them. Them shells had gone within probably 6 days of purchase. And I'm not going to tell you what we made out of them, but that's another story. Just a little thing like that. Like, and then went Mark II, he rang me again.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd got trim shells, you know, down there for Mark II. Like, But I didn't buy any because I couldn't afford it.
But you wish you had now.
Yeah, but when that anti-dive kit came out, just very quickly, they sent me one up, and you used to send you a form with, which you know, an evaluation form, wasn't it? And we put it on, and hell, our old fella says to me, he says, "Yeah, I don't think that'll work, our David." He says, "You're just buggering Ackerman up on that. You're going to have to turn it back. Because wheels have pulled, you know, when you put Twinkam anti-roll bar on Mark II, you know, it puts a lot of strain on, doesn't it?" And we put this bloody thing on, bolted it up. And I tested all my cars on Arnott and Reiners. Because I was on there on breakdowns about every other day of the week. And we used to go up about 2 o'clock in the morning. And that were it. We used to put cones across the road. And that was it. We could do full 12, 13 mile right down into, you know. And I couldn't believe how this thing turned, you know. That anti-dive kit, it made it turn in so bloody quick, and it was handleable. Wore tyres quick. And we come back and we decided we'd go garden. Do you remember when we shoved that bloody Mark II Escort on top of a wall? You know, bloody people walking and horses, off we went up garden. And it just would not, that anti-dive kit was absolutely no good on rough road. It was just useless. It used to bounce too much. But we had the edge for a bit, till every bugger else copped up with it and started biting them off bar and leg. But it was good, you know, and they didn't want it back. We've said, well, you know, "Do you want it back?" "No, we don't want it back." They give us all sorts of things, like, you know, we were lucky. Got full. I couldn't buy RS parts off Ford's, even with my discount with garage, like. I could buy them a lot cheaper direct out of Boreham than I could off Ford's, like off the RS. You know. So that was handy. Handy when you were poor. I go on to Mr. Mapple now. Follow that. We're not talking about that.
Roy, I think you were the only one that ever drove six wheelers on rallies. Yeah. Those three.
Yeah. I was the type of rally driver that I didn't enjoy stages at all. Yeah. It took me a long time. If I survived the first quarter of an hour of a road event, we were always up there. I'm not saying win it, but we're always up there. But surviving that first quarter of an hour for me was terrible, so I couldn't stop start. I did the RSC twice. I won it in 65, the class. Started off at number 30, and we won the class with that car. And who did they have navigated for me? Oh, Graham Mars. And we fell out. You always seem to fall out with navigators, don't you? Navigators, they're always right. They're not. And I did it the second year with Tony Mason. BMC gave me an engine because of winning my class in the first year, and in 66 we did the RSC again, and it blew a head gasket on the second stage, and we didn't have the chance to change the gasket, and we had to keep putting water in it, and we finished up, I think it was third in class on that. We were lucky to finish third in class, really, but I was not a stage driver. Then I got a Ford Escort and drove for Thomas Motors. It had a Pinto engine in it. Jeff did a lot of rallies in that with me, didn't he, from Thomas Motors at Blackpool, and we were very successful in that car. We really did win a lot of rallies with it. It was all right. But believe it or not, my favourite car for rallying was a Rover V8 automatic. I've never lost a rally in that car, and it was the only car I took out when my rally car wasn't. It was my own personal car. And We started a rally once at Settle, and we were car number one, and it was a Rover V8 automatic, and there's another lad turned up in an Opel Manta, and they called him Goldfinger, and I thought, who the hell is this? And that was it, just Goldfinger on the entry sheet, and he was number naught. Anyway, when it comes to where the lad's in, he's starting off in front of me. It was Barry Williams, Wizzle Williams, and Don Barrow. So, like, they were a fur crew, you know. And it was through trough. Well, I know trough pretty well. And we hammered this car through trough, and we came back to settle for petrol. And we were, I think it was 9 minutes up on them with this car. But
on the Rover at the back, it had the D and axle. It was a funny arrangement at the back, and inboard discs on the diff, and I came down hard on a yump, and it cracked me diff. And when I got back to settle, we noticed oil was coming out of it, so I put it on the ramp, and we tried all sorts of stuff to try and seal it. But unfortunately, we didn't finish the rally. But by the hell, we were flying in that car that day. You know, to be up that much on Williams, you're fairly going, you know. But like with my Mini, it was handy. It was like putting a jacket on. And you know, when we had a puncture, we never used a jacket out like that. Back wheels, they used to just lift it up, and they put wheels through my legs. I got down. And to lift front up, I used to open the door and just lift car up and then put wheel on. And we used to practice all this, changing wheels. We used to practice opening gates. You don't know gates today, but we used to have gated sections in the old days, you know, and they were fun. I mean, you could shut the gates on the fella behind you. Tommy Mason used to take padlocks with him. We used to practice opening gates. You come to a gate and say, it's your side away, you know, and there's like that, and switch reversing lights on, and they come running upside the car. And we were raining hard one night, and these navigators are very, very fussy about the maps. Really fussy, and pissing down one night. And Mini door, they had to open it because of them sliding windows. It was the old fashioned one, you know. So Marshall gets in, just trying to get his hands through. And I'm looking at it, and direction of approach, time, and away, and I'm in gear ready to go. And I set off, door slams to, and I hear this screeching, I'm just changing to second. And there's a fella getting his Mac caught in my car. Have you ever seen a fella trying to take his Mac off at 30 miles an hour? We had a lot of fun, we did a lot of rallying, and I thoroughly enjoyed what I did. I wouldn't like to do it today, too old anyway, but we did have a lot of fun with it. And Thomas Motors, I rallied with them for quite a few years, and then I just suddenly packed it up on the Shunpiker. It was halfway old, was it? It was a day section and a night section, and then it was a big rally with the Shunpiker. You remember that, don't you, Jeff? And Gavin Frew was team manager at Thomas Motors, and I was lying third after daylight stages, and I don't like daylight rallying at all, any sort, even closed roads, I'm not interested. But at night I was alright, and I was lying third, and Frew came up to me and he said, "What are you doing, Matt? We're around with that brake on." And I thought, oh God, that's it. And I just handed him keys and that race, I come on my bus. And I never had it since. Left him with care. And that race.
Oh, you did some caravan rallies after.
Oh, yes. We did all right with them.
Yeah, most people don't believe that we used to race them around.
Race with a caravan on back. And we drove for Linton's. Caravans are bankrupt now. They built special caravans for us, and hell, they were fast. Mm. It wasn't just like, you know, and you had to carry all your food in and everything. And we went over whites, and stones were flying up off back at car, a Rover VA, wasn't it? Back at car and through front at body of caravan, and bed at front was full of bricks, you know. But we did very well with that. And they used to do driving tests at Alton Park, reverse and driving tests and stuff like that.
With that Mallory at 84 miles an hour. The guy who had Polar Ford, he owned Polar Ford over at Barnsley. His name now. Anyway, he supplied Granadas to Linton's. And he beat us. He got 90 miles an hour round Mallory with a Granada pulling one of those Linton scouts.
Yeah.
But he broke both front window off caravan and back window to get a better airflow.
They used to put laybys on the side of the road. And on these laybys, they had different tricks what you had to do, like. And one of them, they made you run up onto a block and show your caravans like this, and you had to level your caravan.
So all of Mum schools got wind around to wipe to
no,
the side.
You picked
up.
It up.
So, yeah, to make it level, with spirit level on back window. John Brown comes in, drives off bloody block. They're level. It would not be a mile, I never thought of driving off block. And he just drove off block. But I was going to tell you something else then, but I was really interrupted, wasn't I? It was something about, oh, I know, something about RAC rally. And I was with Tony Mason. And we were doing all right on it, although, as I said, their gasket had gone, but we were doing quite well at rally. And Pat Moss came in behind with a big Ely, and we went through Kielder. It's probably the longest stage as I know of. I'm not a big, but is it about 16 or 17 mile long Kielder?
Yeah.
Rough. And I mean, in a minute, it's double rough. And she came up, she must have lost a lot of time, and she was behind us. And he set off, obviously, at minute intervals. And I said to Mason, I said, look, we're going to have to keep an eye on her, like she's going to be bombing past us in a bit. Anyway, we got a few miles into the stage before we saw her coming. And she was coming, so I was looking for somewhere to go so she could pass. And I pulled off slightly, still going, but I just pulled off onto this wide bit. And she blew on her own, and next thing I saw, she hand come out of the window, fag end come out, and she blew and waved. And she was going out, and she was blowing on the horn at the same time. this stage, couldn't believe it. But she smoked like a trooper did, Pat, but they were quick with them cars. You know, man, I never went that quick in the car. But my car wouldn't go that quick.
She was incredible, that one. She got on Kirkson before they went into Waddington, and she was in a big alien.
I can't hear you, David.
I watched her going up Kirkson. It was like a selective up Kirkson pass before the RSE went into the Ward. And she just absolutely, it was unbelievable. She was
really was. I'll tell you, was in the same team as us on the caravan rallies, Rosemary Smith.
We had Pat Moss, she was in.
Yeah. And
she
cost
us the rally.
Rosie Smith was in our team, wasn't she?
Yeah. She was Irish.
I love them rallies, you know. I love that caravan thing. They have a photograph of me with Rover V8 over a Yump. And all six wheels are off floor. Caravan chair. And there. They were lovely. I think I won about four of them. Did all right with them.
Carry
and
on,
they,
carry
then
on.
They stopped it. There were 2 minutes interval.
Carry on.
Yeah. But you just forgot the caravan was there. You just never thought out about it. I did one rally, it was on its bloody side of the caravan, I didn't know. I just chipped it back up. You sit on that one, Cyril. You're bigger than me.
I'm a safe.
Don't fall off, Cyril.
I'm sorry, I'm gonna embarrass you first of all, because it's a few years now since you've been, well, not necessarily been to the club, but you did come and speak some years ago. I think you'd still, had you still got the Manta then? Or maybe you just, maybe
well,
you just stopped.
I had the Manta in 85.
Well, it must have been a bit after then. I have got a long memory though.
Yeah.
Sorry everybody, I'll just go back with Cyril. How far back was it when you, sorry, that sounds terrible, that. Where did you start rallying?
Started rallying as a co-driver or navigator in 64, I think it was.
So you were all about the same sort
yeah,
of time then,
yeah.
Really?
And I did quite a few rallies, but I got interested actually by, I used to live in Langley where Jeff Smith lives. And I used to go up to Jeff's to look at the cars that were picking you up on Saturday night. And I used to stand there and look at these minis you've got in the way coming on time. And, what was two Tomlinsons?
Yeah.
Two Tomlinson
lads,
both had mini cars.
David and Jim.
And I used to just admire these cars. And I thought, well, that's what I should be doing really. But at the time, I couldn't afford the cars anyway because I was doing motocross with the bike, so it was a bit difficult. So I started co-driving, navigating with an
lad called David Bell, who had his dad had motorbikes in Blackburn, but you know, probably remember him. And we weren't doing
so
bad.
Is that the same David Bell who lives in Wally now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he actually lives in
Well,
he lives in Langmore, yeah.
LAC.
Yeah. He was okay, David, on the dry road, but if it was wet, he didn't just seem to be able to cope with it. And we were going up through the start of the trough one night, which I know nearly as good as this man. But we were coming up to that 90 left at Bruce Mall, and the road was wet, full of leaves. It froze up on the brake pedal. It's just going dead straight, dry stone wall. I thought, not good this. So I just said, brakes off, go right. Took your brakes off and shot up the farm track on the right. And he stopped and he turned to me and says, thanks mate. And I thought, I'm in the wrong seat here. So I went back home and I borrowed £30 off my girlfriend. And I had £30 of my own and bought a Mini. £60. Then we started with an 850 Mini, solid shell, 1959 Mini, completely knackered engine. But it was really cheap because somebody had red-leaded it outside. All the seams were red lead, so it didn't look good. That's my first rally car.
Fantastic.
So it did well. It did. Jeff did rallies in it. The green one, Jeff. Not the white one.
Memories
fade. Yeah. It was a good car. That shell, the first shell, were a lot lighter, weren't they? So that made a bit of difference as well. It was only 850.
And when you mark that, you need a blaster.
So was it all road rallies that you did then?
It was all road rallies. Up till through a stage of Minis, I got that one. Then I built another one from scratch with a bare shell. And then I got sponsorship from Minisport and built another one with bits provided by them. And we did the Motor New Championship. 72, 3 and 4 with two of those cars, and we finished up fourth and second. I think in 75 we were second, and they wanted me to go again the year after, but I was up against BDAs and it was just getting a bit difficult with the Mini, so I decided they wouldn't go into stage rally at that time, and I didn't want to go on another year's road rally, so we split up and I went into stage rally with I got a car from Austin Rovers, well, British Leyland. They gave me Group 1 Mini, and we did the Open Championship with that, and then the year after we did the same championship again, and they gave me all the bits to build a Group 5 Mini, which was for the Autosport Championship. And that car had the best bits you could ever get for Mini on it, and it was a lot of rubbish. It just wouldn't work. And we tried everything with it, and it was undrivable. It had a Longman engine, a limited slip diff, sponsor suspension, probably too much gear, and it wouldn't drive. It was a horrible thing. If you don't believe me, ask Ian Grinrod.
That'd be a long story.
That took it to the end. That's taken us to the end of the session anyway.
Fantastic. Well, while we're talking about Minis, a little bit of a extension on the Mini. It wasn't really a Mini, it was a Metro.
Yeah.
So Ian, you got involved with Metros. What was the story behind that?
Right, well, I got involved with it was really Cyril put me onto them. They told me there was these 200 that were built. Many of them were being sold off. We asked him over when the Group B days were off. He said they can be bought, these things. And I think they were, I seem to remember they were about 16 grand. Anyway, big do's and little do's. I was a bit slow off the mark and didn't get any of that batch. And they all went all over the place. But then I got chatting with a guy down in Wiltshire, and he was buying these things, stripping the engine out and selling the engine separate, one thing another. So So I finished up buying a few, and I finished up with more than a few. I finished up with a load of them. And some had engines and some didn't. Mm-hmm. Some had the original prototype engines in, which were V6, which was basically a V8 that Austin Rover had cut the cylinder out and welded them back up again. Same with the cylinder heads, a fantastic piece of engineering, and they really worked.
I remember seeing one of those at your place.
Yeah,
Harry Radcliffe not do that. Harry Radcliffe, at Vita.
I don't think so, did he? I think
he chopped the Rover engines up by.
Yeah, but these were the prototypes, and that's exactly what they were. And then they were triple Porsche carburetors on them, and they were really good. Some were 2.7, some were 3 litres. So, but I bought a load of these things as rolling shells, or they perhaps just have a gearbox in but no engines. So a few I did put some V8s in, and then I came across another guy that had bought a load of gear out of Austin Rover, and there were a load of these prototype engines there, these V6s. So of course a lot of them then got the V6 engines in. They all got sold off, and then I got my first proper one with the real engine in, and then I went on from there and bought a few more. So I think I probably had about 20 altogether,
yeah,
of
yeah.
the 200. So
and
if I kept them, I'd be a rich man now.
Was
I know
what
it was, 70 mile.
Yeah. I didn't actually compete in one, but I did quite a few course cars.
Oh, I remember you doing course cars.
Course
like
car
Rock
a few times, yeah, that's right. Cause I wanted to try and keep them. They were new cars with no miles on them. I didn't really want to hammer them and stage them, so I just did course cars and stuff with them, but really, really enjoyed them. Brilliant cars, brilliant.
That leads us on to Cyril, of course. You had a lot of involvement with the Metro.
Yeah, I was lucky enough. When I stopped with the Minis, I got to deal with Blydenstein basically to buy Brooks's Chevette kit. I didn't know at the time, but it stopped because we bought that. I then got sponsored from Crossport and Blackburn, which was a good move. That's a story in itself, because there was a guy in the village where I live had a Porsche 928, I think it would be. And he always seemed to drive it through the briskly. And one day he's coming out of the village, and I was in the TR7 V8 up behind him. And I didn't dog him or anything, I just sat back up close to him. So a cloud of crap came out of his Porsche, and it's off up there. And I just sat up the back of him. No big problem, really. Just up the fast bit of road up to the main road, and then off we went into town. And I thought, that guy must be fairly interested in motoring. So I did a bit of research and found he's a managing director of Crossport. So I sent him a letter asking if I could have a meeting to discuss the possibility of rallying, which they agreed to. So I went in, there were two directors, and sat down, and one of them looked at me and said, "You've already cost this company a lot of money." I thought, this isn't going to plan. I said, "Why's that?" He said, "You're the man with that TR7 in Ribchester, aren't you?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, I'm the man with the Porsche 928 in Ribchester." And he said, "When you did that with my Porsche," he said, "I sent it in for service because I didn't think it was going right." So that sort of broke the ice a bit. We got a good sponsorship from Crossport. So that was, we bought the Chevette from Blydenstein. That was the best deal I've ever done, because it came with a van, spare engine, gearbox, axle, everything, 32 mini lights, wheels and tyres, jacks, everything you could want in the van. You've been using the van, ain't you?
Mm,
fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was, believe it or not, it was 14,000 for the whole lot. And I found out later that if he hadn't have sold that, he'd have gone bust. So he actually rang, something else he rang me about, and he said, "I'm really glad you bought the kit." Because there was nobody else would take the whole lot. And it was fantastic, and the car was good as well. And then we ended up with a Manta 400 after that from GM. And then we got, they were a bit long in the tooth, the Group B was coming on, so Crossport decided we'd have a go at Group B. So I got an invitation to go down to Dagenham to try an RS200. And the guy showing me this thing was John Taylor. So we're going down Boreham Airfield. And it was a fairly quick thing. But it was left on drive, which I'm not over keen on. But anyway, I did a few laps and there was a, like a long sweeping left hander which I was passing around at about probably top 100 miles an hour. And I just thought, I wonder how this thing works when you back it off, because it was also just pretty straight driving up to then. So I just backed the throttle off and it just went round like a bloody top. And I was like, Christ, what's going on here? So we did 360, by which I'm on the grass, still doing 100 miles an hour. I managed to get it down to about 50 and I thought, that will be all right. Somebody left a concrete slab about that thick in the grass over this concrete slab. End of August 200. He said, well, if you don't get another one. I said, don't bother, I don't want one. So that put me off that car. It turned out, I got a phone call from Malcolm Wilson a while after. He says, I believe you crashed your RS 200 at Boreham. I said, I did, yeah. He said, what did you do? I said, I just lifted off the throttle and it swapped ends on me. He said, yeah, he did that to me when I drove it as well. He said, the back diff locked up when you do it.
Oh, effective firm running now, aren't they?
Just like that, you know. I couldn't do anything with it. So we then decided we'd try a 604. So we got a good deal from Austin Rover, providing me the 604 and all the bits to make it an evolution one, which is a fairly serious amount of equipment. And that car was fantastic. I mean, Ian was in it once. I remember at Aintree as we run the course car, and it probably remembered it. The brakes were the biggest thing on it. They would stop unbelievably. You just couldn't believe how quick they stopped. And Ian was in it, the probably first time he'd been in one. And we were coming up to the chicanes at Aintree, just running the course car. And he was pushing the floor pan out. I changed up two more gears. And he just don't believe it. And when I first drove it, typical of that car preparation, a bit last minute, I drove it down the start and put the Galway around. I'd never driven it before. And I was actually going up the corners and stopping and having to change down to get to the corners. And it was so unbelievable on the brakes. In any surface, you could stop it anywhere. Soon get used to it. And it went through it.
So that would have been what, sort of mid 80s, would it?
That was 86.
86.
Yeah.
And then from that you went on. Did you run Colin McRae?
Yeah, we went Wendy Bang Group J. I went. I'm not boring anybody, I went racing with the Nesro, which was a bad idea really. Because the other class, I think it was Cheshire Car Club, other class for Group D rally cars. Well, they banned Group B rallying, but they still had a class for racing Group B rally cars. So I went with full Group B, no problem. Won the race, which he could have done anyway. Got best novice, because I'd never raced before. And they came up after and said, I'm sorry, you can't compete in the championship, because you got the wrong car battery on. I said, why? So it's supposed to be single car battery now. I said, no, it's a Group B championship. This car's for Group B. Ah, but you can't run it like that in Group B and rallying. I said, we're not rallying, we're racing. All the guys that were doing the racing came up and said, you can't chuck that out, people ought to hear it. You know, it's only a bit of fun anyway. They threw me out. I said, unless you put single car on, you can't come. I said, I'm not coming then. So that was the end of that. So we got rid of that and then got a Cosworth. It's the first time I had a Ford. Sierra Whale-tail Cosworth. And I ran that in Group N. Then we got a deal to run Colin McRae. First of all in my car, because Ford was supposed to provide us with the bits to build a Group A car for him. By which then we started Rally Park, which was a rally business within Press Park. And Ford were late with all the bits, so Colin ended up driving my car, and then we built the Group A car for him, and ran him in 1989, it would have been, probably. And believe me, if you want to be in a car with Colin McRae, he's unbelievable. He can have any car, completely on its limit, with its possibilities, and all the full conversation with him. Just talks, and he's right on the ragged head, and he just talking about. Unbelievable. We had a young lad working with us who looked like all young lads, the guns at best rally driver in the world. And he's like, if I had a car, I could race anybody. And Colin came to try it one day. So I just took him on one side, said, just do me a favour, will you? Just take this young lad up the road. And he came back with a green. So he suddenly found out he wasn't just as good as he thought he was.
So all of a sudden, in 20 years, you've gone from a navigator who's thinking these drivers are a lot of crap to running a team that's running a potential, well, not a potential, a future world champion.
Yeah.
That was some fair rise, that, wasn't it?
It was pretty good, yeah. Yeah.
And you managed to drive a few events as well. And you managed to drive a few events as well.
Oh yeah, I did all the Irish Tarmac Championship from 83, 84, 85 and 86, and all the time I got to the British Championship. And in 85 we were leading the Irish Championship and it came to the Manx, and I had a throttle jam walking on the mountain about 100 miles an hour, just on a bend like a flip left where you just needed to back the throttle off to twist it in. And it didn't back off, and it went up one of these bankings. And I'm going along the banking like 100 miles an hour thinking, I might get away with this. But there was a gateway into a field. So it went across the gate, smack into a concrete gate post, and started somersaulting and whatever. And there was a telegraph pole far away, but it kept appearing at all these different angles. And I thought, we'll hit this bloody pole before it finished. And my co-driver Derek, he's the coolest guy in the world, he sat through about two or three power rolls and then he tried to go end over end, and he sat there and he said, I don't like the looks of this. So the whole thing came to rest eventually, back on its wheels, funnily enough, and but it wouldn't go because the front end was about 2 feet shorter than it should have been. But two funny things really. The first thing was it wore an inch off the radio aerial without damaging the roof, which was a bit strange. And also we knocked a cameraman out of a tree. And he came and complained, he was really set into me. He said, just knocked me out of a bloody tree. And Derek said, you should have climbed further up, shouldn't you? So that wrecked the mountain, so I couldn't finish the tour at the Irish Championship. So I think we could possibly, we've only one round to go to Cork. And we only need to finish in the top five to win it, so I don't know. But we didn't.
So thinking back, was most of your rallying tarmac then? Did you do any
forest? No, I did some forest stuff. I did a year with the Min in the forest, which isn't good, believe me, especially the Scottish. A bit like Roy with his caravans, we were doing the Scottish in the Min, and I came in and said to Jim, the mechanic, I said, this thing won't put skin off a nice pudding, it's bloody awkward. So I started looking around, they both two service, I started laughing. I said, what's wrong? He said, come here. Underneath the back seat, there's about 2 tonne of stone piled up under the seat because he pushed the floor up and it was just pushed the floor down. It was just acting like a big scoop and we just grading the forest. So I went along. So I shoveled all that out and it was okay. But it was a ridiculous thing, the group one, you couldn't undershield the car. So imagine you're in a Scottish rally in a minute. You could put a sump car on, you couldn't undershield the body. It was hopeless. I'm glad it wasn't my car. To be fair to you, it did a full season of forest rally, like a standing mini, and it stood up to it fairly well then, when you think about it. But it wasn't really good fun.
So Ian, you were similar sort of time, you were in your what would have been Astra, right?
Astra in the early 80s, yeah.
So you were doing quite a lot of forest rallies.
Yeah,
forest and top. And how did you manage the forest?
If I had a choice, I think I preferred the tarmac, but I did get into the forest eventually, and then once I got into it, I started to enjoy it more. But I think really tarmac was really my thing rather than the forest. But I did enjoy it. There was still, you had to do it. It was a championship, so you had no choice. Some of them were tarmac, some of them were forest, so you had to, you just had to do it. So I got into it eventually and I started to enjoy it. Yeah, cool. Good.
Dave, have you ever had any forays into the forest, or has it always been your realism?
Well, no. I did about three. I did the Granite City.
Bloody hell.
Years ago, innit?
You did pick the West Forest Rally you could find, didn't you?
Yeah.
You didn't
do it
in a minute,
or
did you?
No. I did it in a minute. We were 13.
You're 13?
The only one I ever did.
Oh.
You remember that?
I do, yeah.
Yeah. No service crew. A lot of spares in boot.
That's it. Let's get on with it.
And you needed plenty of them,
and we even did one stage twice because old Vites was that pissing. We did second stage twice. I said to him, I said, I bloody recognise him. Oh, bloody hell. And he'd been on Clark and one or two more. Clark went off big stand. But they'd been on drink till about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Them were the days when you could get away with doing things twice.
And David Smith did that, and him and Chris Penrise, and they were going back to the digs. We were stopping up at this near hotel at headquarters, and they were going back to their digs. And next morning we set off on rally. And we're going down, you know, I don't know whether everybody knows Aberdeen, there's loads and loads and loads of roundabouts. Smith's car was on top of the bloody roundabout in a flower bed. Night before. Anyway,
well, then you've got to tell us that one.
Well,
we went down to a motor news event, started down at Welshpool, and I never really enjoyed them. It was a long way to go, you know. Been working on your car, you set off at Saturday dinner and you went down South Wales like, and it was snowing very hard, and I thought this rally's never going to start. Anyway, we're going down, we're just short of Welshpool, and we come down this hill, and then the roundabout, it was shot ice, and my car, it didn't matter what you do, I was a sledge, and that's all it was. I couldn't do no wheels, everything was. And I hit this bloody roundabout, and I finished up in bushes in the middle. And my car was enclosed, you couldn't see it from road. And we got out of the car, grandma's with me, we got out of the car, and we looked around, and some women come out from a house, are you alright, like? I said, yeah. And then police come, and they said, looked around, and said, well, it's not your fault. The lights weren't on at roundabout, you know, keep left signs. I come down bloody hill or something. So anyway, that were it. It was getting on now, we had accidents and we weren't going to start the rally because my front wheels were off it. And so I rung my dad up to come out with trailer, and we had to find a hotel, and coppers come around and find this hotel. Couldn't find this one, so we slept in prison all night. in Newport. So we got up all the morning, my dad had come with trailer, and we were hooking car up. And underneath the car would keep left sign. Never heard no more. First time when I started rallying, I was going to be a navigator, I thought I was. Sick as a dog. I was in bed for 2 days, it was awful, I only went 3 miles. And my map, I looked at my map, and I plotted first reference, I thought I did. We're in the middle of the North Sea. Somewhere wrong with this. And I looked at numbers, and there's 6-figure references, aren't there? Like, you know. And I said, there's never like that on my map. I never thought it was. And we buggered off and went over. But talking about accidents, on one rally, one particular rally, we turned over on 3 separate accidents during the rally, and we still won the rally. But that was some going. And then another one, Jeff was with me. I don't know where we were, you know where we were, I don't know where we were. But I went off on a right-hander over this cliff edge. And front of the car was just hanging over cliff edge. Bob Lamb and Tony Mason come up behind us. Tony Mason gets out of the car and had one of these roof lights. What the hell we needed one of them for? Must have had bad navigators looking at signposts, mustn't we? We had one of these. And Tony Mason was had his legs out of the car with my door open and waving this torch, this light, behind us to make sure that nobody come round for
us. He was against the roof.
And set off, we come round the corner and hit him, knocked him through the other side of the car. And I'm underneath front of it with car on my shoulders trying to lift it back up onto the road. He knocked my door off and Bob Lamb's chased his door down the road. And you finish a rally with no windscreen, believe me, finish one with no door and it's freezing. Put the door in back of car, wind comes in, goes round the car and goes out again, so you get it twice. But some of the accidents I had were horrendous.
So, did you ever go into the forest then?
I went, did the RAC twice.
So
the Monte Carlo rally.
Monte Carlo?
Yeah.
Oh, there must be some stories from Monte Carlo.
Did he ride a lad called Roy Kirkham, a very famous rally driver in the early days. Jeff knows him well. And he was a wild man. And he used to rally a, when I knew, we always used to go, when Jonathan and I were courting, we always used to go to Blackpool Talbot Road bus station. And he lived opposite in a flat above a carpet shop, did Roy. And we used to go to look at his pride, because every weekend it was a different colour. He'd put a bonnet on, or a door on, or a boot on, or a hard top on. And he was going down Ardnock one day, and he went from one to another without road, you know, straight down. And he had a guy called Horace Baton, who was a good navigator. Navigator for me, did Horace. Very quiet lad, worked for the gas board. Never said much. Turn right, turn left, that were it. And he were picking his maps up, car had gone down, hard top was off, and Kirkham going around like him, holding his head like, you know, and Norris Ben picking his maps up, he said, come on Kirkham, we're 2 minutes down now. He left the hard top there and they finished rally. But he was a very good rally driver, very Kirkham. Very quick, very wild.
There's one thing to add to that, Roy,
sorry?
That Sprite, when Sprites had only just come out, I think he won the Illuminations rally and he finished in the Midland at Morecambe.
Yeah.
And some of the lads got hold of the car and they put it on over the top of the porch of the Midland. They put it on roof of the porch. And he went up inside the hotel. When they saw it up there, they had it over the door. So they shouldn't be bloody up there, I can't drive it. And they literally tipped it straight off the roof back down onto the
Yeah. He was a good driver. He was very sad he got killed. There was four of them in this boat coming back from Walney Island one Saturday afternoon. And they hit the sandbank and went straight through the front of the boat. It killed. Three rally drivers got lost that day. Leo Jemson, Jeff Rostron, does anybody know Jeff Rostron? He was a quick driver from London. And Roy. And then another fellow.
Oscar at Rally.
Sorry, Oscar at Rally.
Oscar at Rally. That's what he does.
Named after him. And but that was about 6 months after he did the Monte Carlo rally with me. But he wouldn't drive a stage. I drove every stage. And we were unlucky. I was following this rover, it was one of these army rovers. And he had a habit of switching his taillights off, you know, a car. He went round the right hand bend, switched taillights on, and I went straight on. And unfortunately in the snow, it was a kilometre storm. Didn't knock my suspension off. But we managed to get it back together, the car, and we finished in Monte Carlo, and we were winning the class by 17 minutes, and we were 3 minutes out of road penalties. So it was just, we obviously classed as a non-finisher, but we were 17 minutes up on the rally.
You were still 17 minutes up.
Yeah. And the RAC, I won the class in 65, and I finished third in 64. 66. That's when they got that bad engine. But yeah, but I didn't enjoy stage rallies. I didn't enjoy them rallies. Nah. I just soon go out on a good. I used to love 12 car rallies. Brilliant. Really flyers, you know. Can't do it to their life.
One of the best I enjoyed with you, Roy, if any comments for people, was the Jeans Gold Cup.
In the fog.
Finished in the fog.
Brilliant in fog.
He was brilliant fun. But he was always smoking.
He used to make the fog in my class.
I don't think we lost the rally in fog. We did go right in fog. Went from the newspaper place to finish. Remember it? Yeah, it was a good rally that. Thick fog, hugged it. It levelled everybody out.
Yeah,
you know. I remember Tony Mason being with Peter Clark. And he had a works escort. And his dad used to service for him in a Rolls Royce silver cloud, I think it was. Might not have been a cloud anyway. And he used to come and, like Peter was having dinner, breakfast in the morning. Navigation never used to pay for breakfast, they had to pay for everything. And Peter said, "How have you gone on?" And he said, "Oh, well, we're second or third." We won, Roy won it, like, you know, something it was. And following weekend, brand new Volvo, trailer, that eliminates that excuse. He said, "I'm frightened to get, not be able to get home," and that's what he did for him. Bought him a new bloody car and everything. Money, you see, we had none. We're worse off now since we were rallying.
Does anybody got any questions?
Could I ask each of the speakers, having heard that Minis and V8s have been very high ranking in the sort of favourites, what was your most satisfying to each speaker result, you know, which event and why, you know, what can you bring to mind, which event really, you know, a bit of pride and satisfaction in having got there either because of the problems they encountered or the inferior car you had to compete in, or what would you call as your favourite result?
Well, for me, I would say Circuit of Ireland. It used to go on probably, it was about a 3-day event, maybe one or two nights in bed, I think one night in bed actually. But that there, the one night in bed, yeah. Really, really terrific. I mean, it was a circuit of eight, and you saw a lot, and brilliant stages, and unforgettable. And if you could get around there and win the class, it was even the presentation, it was just a great atmosphere, fantastic. So, circuit for me, yeah, definitely.
Thank you.
I think the most favourable event and the quickest that I ever did was the Hexham. Eddie Graham, which probably one or two of you know, fantastic navigator was Ed. He always put it on, and to go up there, he got Formula One engineering. What did they call it? Oh, good for Formula One. He used to pedal a bloody Mark 1. And all these cars, when I went up there, they all had all writing on them and everything. Like, and we just absolutely annihilated them, and that gave me a great pleasure. You know, it did. And we went up again, and we ended up second on it second time. But yeah, I liked it over there. I really did. Good country.
Yeah,
Cyril.
Me.
Yeah.
Well, we're talking events. There's two events really that I enjoy. One was a tour of Mull. To finish second in a Mini on Mull against a load of 2-litre escorts was quite enjoyable. But the other one, if you ever want to do a good rally, go and do Donegal, because that are some of the best roads you can ever go on. We had some decent results in Donegal. We've never won it, but we finished third twice. And one of the stages which they've now taken out was probably one of the fastest stages I've been on. I like tarmac pace, not rally, and that's the best thing from my point of view. That's what I like best. And this stage was just unbelievable. It wasn't dead straight, but all the bends were flat. And the local guy, he's called Vincent Bonner, he's a quick lad down there because he knows the roads. And we were having a bit of a battle with him. So we went through this stage and got to the end of it and looked at the time, and Vincent had taken about 11 seconds out of me. And I couldn't believe it, so we got into service and I went up to him. I said, "I don't know how you did that." I say, I only put the brakes on once. He said, that's where you went wrong. But the, if you ever get the chance, there is going to go early, because it is a fantastic event, well organised. You're welcome, but some of the events these days, I think, are run for the organisers and not the competitors, which is not good. Typical of that is the Ulster Rally is not very good from that point of view. But Donegal is a cracking event. It's got the roads and hospitality and everything.
Well, mine, probably we didn't win it, but it was probably the Morecambe National. I can't think of what year it was. It was like a day and a night event, you know, and started at Midland. What made it good for me was that I'd just finished with my old Mini, the one I built, and you know, the one I rallied it with, the fur old Miss, when I finished rallying with it, like scripting easy. So I've been all the way around looking at marks on it, you know. They didn't know what I did through night because they were all there before I started. But my uncle bought me a new Mini, 970 Cooper S. And he bought it on the Thursday, well, he collected it on the Thursday for me to rally it on the Saturday. I wouldn't drive it because it was a green one. And I never drove anything green, didn't enjoy green. So they resprayed it orange. And the paint was still wet when I started on Friday night, but, you know, tacky. And we finished third on the rally with a 970 Cooper Air book again. I'll tell you that lad's name, Jeff Halliwell.
That's it.
Are you
it?
Yeah. I thought I'd remember it.
It painted
not
been
long
dry.
Now, yeah. Sorry?
It painted a bit dry. You might as well won it, man.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was a good event for me. I enjoyed that event.
Fantastic.
Any more questions?
Which is your most unusual car you've ever?
I'm all unusual.
So am I.
A55, Austin Cambridge, with front shock absorbers gone. You could look at owls in trains. And it was my dad's, and I used to wash the bugger off in late before I took it on. Because it was a taxi. Yeah, that's a long time ago.
A 3.5 Rover.
That's me. My
yeah.
car, automatic.
My old shape.
The old 2000 model.
No, before that.
Oh, that, right.
Yeah, the one that the Prime Minister used to have, that type of thing. The really big, yeah. That was a big car. There were three of us in it. Because we couldn't afford the fuel, so there were three there. Somebody
yeah, man survived at Mellin Road there. And
yeah.
The mirrors were knocking up wall all the way down.
Yeah, big car. That's my most unusual. We didn't finish where we went, I finished up in a bloody pond somewhere. The following day and tore it out.
Cyril?
I'm struggling with that a bit, really. I drove Jeff Smith of Oliver on one rally.
That'd be an extreme.
Went well, did that car?
Yeah, it did.
123.
123
GT.
Yeah, that was good. Bit like driving a battleship. but I can, just coming on from that, I've been a bit fortunate. I go over to Ireland quite a bit. The guy I know over there where I go fishing, he's big into autocross racing now, which I never knew about, to be quite honest. And it's a massive following, and even in this country. I mean, they get 600 entries here in one event, you know, it's amazing. But I went on an event with him, he just said, well, come and see what's going on. So we went. And he got there, and he had his big transport and all these fancy box trailers. So all these cars are coming out. And I said, what do you need all these for? He said, well, that's mine, that's my wife, that's my sons, that's my daughters, and you're driving that. I said, all right. It's a space frame Mini with two Hayabusa 1200 engine in the back of it, 420 brake horsepower. Start lines where that door is, and I'm sat in it here. I said to him, how do I get this thing off the line then? So they all sort of looked at each other and said, just give it 14,000 revs and let the clutch out. So, tootled off, lined up, eight of us, 14,000 on rev limiter, clutch out. I thought, just spin the wheels up, dig a bit of a hole and go. No, it didn't. It just gripped and went like that. It sat on its back. So I did about 150 yards on back wheels. I backed it off and bonnet came down and I'm in the lead. that car was, I mean, you talk about 6 or 4, that was unbelievable. A serious amount of power. And no way.
How much to wait on that would be amazing.
Oh, it was incredible, yeah. So, sorry it's not a rally car.
And did you win a race?
I finished second in my first race, which was pretty good. The bad bit was I beat the guy who lent me the car.
so that was the end of that one.
I got three more cars out of him. So, the next one was a Honda Fireblade, two Honda Fireblade engines in the back of a Fiat, with a chintzy counter or something, a little Fiat. Believe me, they are serious.
Sounds fun, that.
Oh, yeah, but they don't mess about. The engines are about 20 or 30 grand. They're real fancy bits of kit. They don't look it. When you go up first, I think it's banger racing. But when you look at what they've got, suspension and everything, is all top notch stuff. On the top car,
yeah.
They're like serious.
Fantastic. Any more questions?
I've got one for Ian, or a story. I remember watching you out linking the 78, 79 doing a motoring news round, and you were doing it out in possibly a sales car. It was a fastback Cavalier. Tell us a story about it.
A red one. Yeah.
I know you were the top 10 finish in the motoring news round, out in 90 starts or something like that.
Around that time, it was all rallies. If you went out on a Saturday night, it'd be a 12 car on a Friday night. But I had a habit of buying cars and not keeping them. So go and do a rally and then sell it. And then buy another one and sell it. And that's what I was doing. And that particular Cavalier, yeah, that was a sales car. Yeah, quite right, yeah. Just a absolutely
box
standard, yeah. And it was so good that after that I got an Opel Ascona 1.9 that was also a standard car.
Yeah.
And we started winning rallies in that car. And it was only a 1.9, a standard car, but it handled really well. So I kept that for quite a while. But I was always changing cars, always. And I have been known to get higher cars as well. Higher
so
on a Friday. The what?
The
Max. The Max, that was our car. Or was it a brown one? I think it was a brown one.
Did anybody ever?
A white one was it. That was our car, yeah. Because it was rally. Every weekend there was a rally. If it wasn't a Saturday night, it would be a Friday night. But and sometimes didn't have a car. So go to the local garage, hire a car, go out and do the event. Back on Monday morning, clean it up, take all the numbers off, and there you go. As long as you didn't bump it, you were fine. So that went on for quite a while, yeah.
You ran a cadet for a while, didn't you? Yellow and black one.
Yeah. Yes. Now then, that was a good car as well.
And the old Babbin.
Road. Eh?
And
the
old Babbin.
Yeah, the had a very short front on it. This fellow came to me one night and said, Cyril, will you come out with me in this minute? So what do you think about it? I think it's pretty good. And I thought, sounds a bit dodgy, but yeah, I will do. So off we went. Up a road that I know fairly well, it's about a mile from where I live. So he's going over a brow, and I'm thinking, I'm not going to go around this next bend. Brow drops off, drives through the wall, bang, straight through it. Down the field, eventually stop. He says, what would you have done there? I said, well, I wouldn't be going that way, past the start.
Yeah, it's true. But going back to the Opel Cadets, yeah, they were brilliant. There was a red and white, and then I had a white one, which I got off Jeff Burkitt, and that had all the bits on it, all the Webers and everything like that. That was a fantastic car. And I remember winning three rallies in a row with that particular car, which I'd never done before. So they were brilliant days, those. I did bump one on mud. I went off one of those on mud. quite a bit of an accident, but apart from that, superb.
Is that when you finished up on rocks?
Yeah. Just going too quick. We'd done the pace notes and everything. We'd done the stage thing during the afternoon, that was fine. And we'd done everything was okay in the pace notes, but when we're checking them, obviously doing 40, 45 mile an hour. When you go over a bit of a slight bump, which was nothing, at sort of 80, 85 mile an hour, and you turn the wheel and nothing happens. There was only one way we were going, that was off. And that was a big
long way off.
It was a long way off. That were a big accident, that, yeah.
So whereabouts was that on board?
Quite a long way
off. Yeah, yeah. I tried to forget about that one.
I've been done 20 odd miles, I suppose. It's a bit, but it's, I think the rest of the club is also ingrained in more. The rest of you, have you ever done more?
No.
Right, do you? And how did you go on?
Eight, second and 12th.
So how long ago? this town's terrible. Is how long
second in 18, sorry, no, second in 75 with Nigel Raven in the mini sport, in the last mini sport meeting. And then
so would that have been a mini sport sponsored mole? No, it probably
no.
That'd be before mini sports.
I'm not sure what year it was. He asked me to drive it again. It was a one off. Not sure what year that was, but I don't know what they've done at it, but they've taken all the suspension off it that I had on it. And it didn't work. And we finished 12th. Did you do that with Jeff, you know? Yeah, we went off the road somewhere, didn't we? Which is a ditch somewhere.
Probably
you probably miscalled me a bend or something.
Tony Mason once said to me, straight on the tee. Straight on the tee, bloody old bloody ego.
I must call it
flustered.
Jeff was one of.
Right there talking about navigate, but what you have to remember, everybody, there's four of them there, they're all drivers, and as any navigator knows, most drivers don't really know the right from the left.
I think this is going to have to be a future night, but I think we should be getting all the navigators up here to tell us.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
One of my first navigator, Graham Mars, was never wrong. And we're going up, and he kept reading road. I never really liked him reading road to me. I'd rather let me do road, you know, just tell me where baddens were, and where, you know, hairpins were. That's all I need to know, where the 90s were and where the hairpins were. And we were going all wrong up this road, and everything was wrong. I was all over the bloody place. And he kept saying, this road no has map. There must have been edges on each side, 12 foot high. It'd been there since Adam were a lad. It just wasn't just a map. And they always have an excuse, don't they?
The driver's not doing what you're telling
them.
No, I was back Jeff was one of the top navigators I've ever had in my car, didn't
he? Oh, he's a navigator, yeah.
Yeah.
There's some good navigators and some good drivers came out of this area, though.
Yeah,
right. There really was, you know.
Well, I think this area is one of the few areas that had drivers and navigators that could go competitively rallying anywhere in the country.
Aye.
Because we had every type of road. And if you go anywhere else, like if you go down Wales, they've never seen a straight in their lives. So they don't know what they're doing. You go into Yorkshire, they've never seen a bend. So, if you look at it, all the people from this area used to do really well anyway, like on multi news events. You know.
Yeah. You used to be able to tell the light, you know, seven in the late, we used to have Frank Davis and Bob Redhead. And if we went to Yorkshire or Derbyshire or Lancashire, we had to get that far in front before we hit Cumbria because you couldn't compete with him. And Scaife, here. You know, you couldn't compete with him because of local knowledge. As he said, he went up Rhinos every other day, and I'm not, you know, what you can't compete with that,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And they think they're good.
We're not for that, were they?
Talking about navigators. I'll get it.
I'll be careful.
I was asked to arrange a bachelor party for one of the, was it David or Graham?
David.
It was David Leach. Up in the lakes, and we started off on the Saturday morning. You were there, weren't you? There was Tony Werswick, there was yourself, chap with the hat off Mull, PA man, what's he called?
Paul.
We got a lot of them anyways. They came up in the minibus. Anyways, first of all, we started having a drinks at Elm Trail in Grassmead, do you remember that?
Vaguely.
And then there was this bird, she was a Canadian, real bonny lass, wasn't she, thumbing, so she joined in and we went up to Kirkson Inn and had a few more beers up there and a meal. Then we come down to Lawwood. It was a lovely day, wasn't it? He says to Tony, he says, for Christ's sake, he had a pair of wellies on, didn't he? Turned down,
and his
shirt was bloody filthy, like. And he says, for Christ's sake, did you put a bloody green shirt? And Tony gets, I forgot to turn it round, he says. And then, by this time, things were getting a little bit out of hand. And with Charlie and I were going up into cocktail bar, because it was the only one that was open, wasn't it, in the afternoon. And we found a bloody dead rat. And rat, its hairy bit was still here, wasn't it? But down here was just a skeleton and a bloody tail, wasn't it? Bugger lugs here. Puts it in his glass, didn't he? There was about that much in the bottom of his glass. Him and I were going in for a round. He puts it on top of the bar and he says, I'll have another one like that, it were right tasty. Well, they bloody chucked us out. They banned us. That was just, it was a good day, was that? Remember that MGB outside that bloody... I don't like MGBs. No, I don't like MGBs. The bloody top was off it, wasn't it? Oh. We won't talk about that.
So, Dave, you managed to skip that one. What about Mull?
Mull, I just drink. Well, you lads waste all your money.
I've seen you up there plenty, but I don't ever remember you doing one.
No, I never did Mull.
You never did Mull?
No, I was Marshall.
Because self-preservation.
No, we didn't start going up to Malta about 15 years ago, and we went up to Marshall. I never went to Malta. I couldn't afford 4 days off. I couldn't afford that, you know. I couldn't afford to be away from Spot.
So even when you were doing the Malta news rounds, and you still didn't?
No, we only used to go for a day, like, you know, we were going down, well, that was it, wasn't it?
We had
recovery business, you see, and we were 24 hour. I never slept for years, you know. I've even, Joe has taken car down, when Joe riding, anybody, I don't know where he is, and I wish I did know where he was, but I know him, where did he live? Great Harwood or somewhere? I've seen him come up to Ambleside, park his car up there, drive the car down to Scrutineer, and I would come on in a wagon and meet him and go and do a rally. Time and time again, because we were that busy, like.
I'm trying to think. He did come to a club about 4 or 5 years ago, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. Nobody got an email or anything. Well, I'm not into that, but nobody.
He did turn up, because
he didn't got a phone.
No, I haven't got a phone, no. I've still got some pigeons.
Any more questions?
Surprised Terry hasn't
asked
this.
It's a
bit
brilliant.
What's your favourite piece of road?
Ooh.
What's
one?
Favourite
bit of
road. Right, start with you.
I like to have Notting Round Road.
Could you do it in 12 minutes?
I did it in 12 minutes.
11 and a half? 10?
I've done it under 12 minutes.
I'll tell you how to do it.
I think Jeff will win.
What?
You are?
Yeah, go on.
You do up with every day, you.
I know, I knew every
blade
of grass.
And it was that one I went over it.
I was chasing Bob Bean over there one night. You know when you drop off on the other end going down into Eswell?
Yes.
The road just looked straight. You might have been doing it. It was in Mexico. And road goes, and it a size up, let it back like this. It was about 100 yards off.
I did it in under 12 minutes.
And then we charged him to get it.
He's not listening.
In a caravan.
No. Because roll at that farm at Middle. We had to stop at control.
Did you?
Yes.
usually did, they split it in two, like
they were controller. Yeah.
But when they didn't split it in two, what you used to do, you used to whop out, because I could usually get half a minute, shut the bloody gate and get back into car, and everybody used to, next person come along, shut gate.
If you were the team.
Yeah, I remember
when on the rally once. That was a Morecambe National. No, not Morecambe, Morecambe Illuminations. And you could put a team in of three cars. And there was my Mini, me and my Mini, and it was behaving badly, it wouldn't start, and we were pushing it around bloody car park to get it going. There was Tony Payne in an imp, and Bob Lamb in an imp. I'm an imp. And we all put a team, and they asked me to put team in. Well, I'm scratching around with my car before it starts, and I forgot all about team. And we set off on rally, and we're all three still going, but Bob Lamb, halfway through the second half, broke the cable. And because of team, he had a string through the door, pouring with rain, and it was throttling car with his string. And we were the only one with three cars left in team, but I never put team in. It was pretty upset with Bob.
To be fair, the roads around here are excellent beating. I mean, your Lyth and your Gisborne and all that, they're just fantastic roads. Those are my favourites, I think. We used to use them quite a lot, and I just thought they were brilliant. So
I think you.
Yeah?
Trough. I'm surprised that you didn't go for Trough Road.
This fellow was fairly quick at Trough Road.
I was already in Trough.
I knew Trough pretty well. And we were doing the illumination one, 75 probably. And I got Colin Francis floor driving for me, I think possibly for the first time. So we came up to our place at Ribchester. And it might sound a bit big, but I wouldn't like to come down the trough, sat beside myself. Not knowing what's going on. So I thought, best plan, because it starts up in Lancashire, I'll take Colin up through the trough to give him an idea just what I knew about it. I mean, I knew all three of the Christian names, so.
When did you ever tell him what it is?
You Christian monster.
Come on.
I said, did you have a pair of wellies when you knew all the shape about the Christian name? You don't.
No, you tip them on the back and jump on top of them.
Right, I'll tell you.
Because if you use wellies, you miss out on all snugging.
You know. They've got bad breath.
They've lost it.
Gareth, from West Wales, you know. Gareth.
Gareth,
it's
got to be
Jones, hasn't it? No. West World Rally Space, Gareth.
Yeah.
Lloyd. Yeah.
Well, he comes up a bit, he's friendly with a friend of mine. And he landed up with some roll cage strips about this long. And he always calls me a Lakeland sheep. And I always call him a Welsh sheep. And I said, what's them for? He says, I'm making an absolute fortune, David, selling these. It was on the D-Max. And I said, well, what the hell are they? I said, the bloody roll kit. He said, no. He says, you put them on the back legs, he says, and they don't scratch you. Hey? I've just had a right to it. I didn't recognise.
Can we have a question that brings it back down to normal?
Well, I was just telling you this trough, John. So I took Colin up through the trough to show him these bumps and jumps and everything. And we got up to Lancashire and Brian Harper came up from Minisport and Colin walked up to him and said, there isn't a bus from here to Dunsop Bridge. So we did all right.
Yeah.
Well, then he said to me, what do you want to know going through trouble and what's to do? I said, just sit back and don't say anything.
My son-in-law bought me a ticket for Christmas present. He bought me an hour lesson in flying at Blackpool Airport, and West Air. And
I never really used it. I wasn't really interested in it, really, but he bought it me, and I still have it. And John Westerby, who's the son, he's the one that takes the lessons. I saw him about 2 years later, and my son-in-law just bought a Cobra, and he was in his garage looking at his Cobra, and I walked in this garage, and John was there, and he had a look, right, how are you, like, you know, I'm fine, thank you. I said, John, I said, I've got a lesson with you. He said, for a flying lesson. He said, I know. He said, I've never forgotten that ride you gave me in that rally car. I've never been. I don't know. So that was it.
Have we last final question?
Right, I'm fed up now.
Well,
what were your best win? Your best ever event that you won?
Oh, the RSE for me. The class.
I think we've had this excellent.
Yeah.
Excellent for me. What was your best win? Don't set it out, bro, because you never won it. Don't set it out, bro, because you never won it.
Not right.
That was the second.
Probably Varsity Rally in Wales.
What's that?
Was that one? Not the most unusual round. But it was on a par with the Kilwendy as an event, which we won in a minute. But the Kilwendy, if nobody's ever done that, we went down to do that. There was a little lad in the hotel. People at home in the hotel. Dead keen on the rally, John. He's in to the mini, he's all over the place and looking at everything. And I said, I'm going out watching tonight. I said, right. So we got the first petrol, and he's there, this little lad. He said, I've seen you three times. Brilliant. And that's what it sounded like. I thought, how was he? Must have seen me three times. I'm not a bloody pushbike. And he's seen me in three different places on a pushbike. Before first petrol. And I mean, Jeff will probably confirm it never goes more than 20 miles from the start, and you're just 240 miles. It's just unbelievable.
I once did a rally and I won it and never finished it. what was that rally club at Waddington that used to have BAE?
Lightning.
It was a lightning rally. And the clerk of the court was a lad called Dave Clark, big tall lad. And he was a course car. We were number one, and he set off 20 minutes in front of us to open the course up. And we come up round Nelson here, snowing like hell. And he comes to control number 8, and we were riding behind him. So when he went through the control, I passed him and went up. And never got to number 9. We got stuck. And Graham Marshall with me, and we couldn't get out. And eventually we did get out, but it was about half an hour later, and we motored back to the petrol halls, and they all came in. And Graham said that we can't go home yet because we've won this. I said, what do you mean we've won it? We haven't finished it. We haven't done it. So we won it. And seemingly, the rule is that the marshal's car has to tell every competitor of any route changes, and they changed the route from 8 and went straight to 11, and we were the only one that got to 9, and we won the rally. What a shame, though, for two of us that went out halfway line and like smacking the cars and stuff like that. But we won it. But there are lots of arguments about it. I didn't want it. But Graham Mark was like that. He navigated it like that. Blue big man.
Hey, right, they can read and we can.
I said they can read and we can.
Well, I'm sure we could go on forever, but we've got to draw it to a close at some point. Can I thank all four of you very much?
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
It's been
for
a fabulous
having us.
Night. Thank
you.
A lot of memories. Even for me, and I know you've all got a lot more than I have. Can we give these four a usual Clitheroe thank you?